I'd like to call the meeting to order. Roll call.
President Byrne.
Here.
Trustee Hebden.
Here.
Trustee Schultz.
Here.
Trustee Marquardt.
Here.
Trustee Cook.
Here.
Trustee Schwartz.
Here.
Trustee Williams.
We have a quorum. Would everybody please stand for the Pledge of Allegiance?
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Okay. Any citizens here that wish to address the board tonight on anything other than what's on committee at a whole? If not, forever hold your peace. All right. Proclamation congratulating American Hotel Register on its 150th anniversary. Would you gentlemen like to step forward here?
And lady.
I know this is Jim Leahy. And who is this gentleman?
Sean Leahy.
This is my nephew.
And I'm Linda. I'm Jim's wife.
This is my wife.
Oh, well, nice to meet you.
How are you?
Sean.
Yeah, we actually met years ago.
S-E-A-N?
Yes.
Yeah, I got a son-in-law named it.
I hope we like him.
Yeah, he's on good paper. I got two grandkids, so, you know. Okay, with that said, American Hotel Register's past and present are what make up the ongoing story of a unique American family. In 1865, American Hotel Register Company, originally named the James T. Hare Company, was founded in Chicago to print and bind hotel registration books. At the end of the 19th century, Thomas F. Leahy purchased the James T. Hare Company of Chicago, and in 1903, buys American Hotel Register Company and merges the two companies under one name. Since then, the Leahy family has served as the impassioned stewards of American Hotel Register Company. James F. Leahy Sr. succeeded his father as head of the company in 1932, and he guided its growth for the next six decades. His three sons, Jim, Tom, and Patrick, quickly moved to the third generation of Leahy leaders committed to the progress of American Hotel Register. Tom Leahy spearheaded the company's move from its original Chicago headquarters to Northbrook, and then finally to its present location in Vernon Hills. American Hotel Register has strong community ties and participates annually in the village's Cultural Partners Program that supports activities and events benefiting families of the community. American Hotel Register partnered with Vernon Hills High School to provide auxiliary fields for student sporting events. I gotta digress here. We were driving around doing a windshield inspection with, like, you know, whoever was in the car and myself and Larry Lashin, who was our, you know, past village manager. And then I said, I'm just gonna call Tom Leahy. So, because we couldn't figure anything out. So I called Tom. I said, you know, the high school is in need of practice facilities. And I said, do you have land that they could practice on? And he says, yeah, sure. That was the extent of the conversation. And then, the lease was consummated for $1 a year.
And they haven't paid it.
Well, yeah. So they're in arrears because that was probably almost, it's probably close to 20 years ago.
Yeah.
Or 16 or 17, 16. You know, because the high school opened in 99.
Yeah.
And I can go on about that, but I won't. Okay. All right. Anyway, it was very benevolent and it was wonderful. American Hotel Register worked cooperatively with the village to construct a path between the Vernon Hills Athletic Complex and the auxiliary fields in light of Lacrosse America. Is it close?
It's close.
Yeah, it's close. All right. American Hotel Register's associates is its greatest assets, volunteer their time and talents to make Vernon Hills events non-profitable organization and charitable causes. On July 29th, the 150th business day of their 150th year in business, the company will celebrate its 150th anniversary. Now therefore be it proclaimed that I, Roger L. Byrne, President and the Board of Trustees, hereby express its sincerest congratulations and well wishes to American Hotel Register and the Lay family on their 150th anniversary. Further proclaimed, July 29th, 2015 is American Hotel Register Day in the Village of Vernon Hills and encourage residents to recognize their contributions to the community. Signed by me. So, congratulations. Yeah, go say something, would you?
You folks are very special people, and we're very glad to be here. This is a wonderful community to live in and to hire people in. We have just the most fantastic people we've ever had working for us, and we're grateful for all the things that you folks provide us. So it's a wonderful community. You've got to be proud of yourselves. I'm very grateful for all that you do for us. So,
thank you for all you do for the community.
I just want to say we attended the 4th of July. You have a lot of children in this community.
And on the 4th of July fireworks or the parade?
In the parade.
Yes.
It was amazing. I mean, I've never seen so many children, so families. It was really
remarkable.
That's
good. Well, I think people like our schools, which is a good thing, right?
Thank you.
Thank you. Sean, do you want to say anything? Or?
No, thank you. I appreciate the recognition.
This is Pat's son.
Okay, that's fine.
Yes.
Okay, well nice to see you. I know I probably did meet you.
And Tom, what? Sorry he's not here tonight.
I know, he's in Amsterdam.
Yeah.
I sent him a text. I go, he goes, well, probably not going to be able to make it. I'm in Amsterdam. But he sent me a picture. It looked like a governmental building, maybe City Hall in the background.
Oh,
him and Kathy.
It's a wonderful city, too. Not as wonderful as Vernon Hills, though.
Oh, my God. You're too kind. All right. Well, thank you, and thank you for being part of Vernon Hills. Wait, I have a comment here from Trustee Cook.
Yeah, I just want to say, having been here on the board net since first came on that, it's always so pleasant to work with people that will work with you and be as giving to the community as you are. You're one of the finest examples of a corporate citizen that I've ever encountered anywhere. And we really appreciate how much you support all of the things that you do here in town. I mean, going right back to exactly as Mayor Byrne said, all it took was that one call to Tom and say, can we do this? Sure. And it's always been that way. Whenever we needed, some help with something where you could help us, as a corporate citizen, your company has always been there, and that's we thank you very, very much.
Your people have been a lot of fun to work with too. They're good people. Mm-hmm.
You mean staff?
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay. Because you probably work with them more than you do with us. So.
Well, I'm talking about the police, the fire department.
Right.
Just the people
always been very helpful
who make sure that everything goes well.
Well, that's great.
Thank you.
Well,
thank
again, you. Congratulations, yes. And
I had a comment.
Oh, okay. All right.
It's kind of ironic that the kids' castle is on the agenda tonight, but my first exposure to you, I was not on the board. I was just trying to get the kids' castle built, and we had found out that you, American Hotel, was coming to town, and you were still in Northbrook, and so we called you to see if you could help us with some supplies. And you immediately said, yes, come and get whatever you need. And I was like, wow. And at the time, I wasn't even on the board. I was just a mom trying to build a playground. And yes, you helped us out tremendously. And so I thought, wow, what a great company. So
thank you.
We're always here.
Works both ways.
Yes.
Thank you.
Okay.
As long as everybody's jumping on the bandwagon
okay.
here.
Trustee Schultz.
One more. In another life, I was also the past president of the Material Handling Society of Chicago. And I want to say that these folks opened up their facility for a tour and an educational forum for us. And not many companies will do that these days. It's very difficult getting companies to have tours. This was about 2 or 3 years ago. And again, shows the kind of character that the organization has, that they're willing to share and support educational opportunities. So again, thank you from that other hat that I wear on occasion.
Thank you so much.
All right, well, congratulations and thank you.
Good luck with your work tonight.
All right.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay. All right, okay. Village Board will meet once in August on August 11th. Why?
Because you all wanted to take one meeting off that month because of being out of town, vacation, going back, prior to going back to school, et cetera, okay. Et cetera.
Well, if we need to, though, we can have one.
I promise you, Your Honor, you will not need a second meeting in August.
You don't think so?
Nah, I don't think so.
So everybody's taking the month off.
Well, no, but.
No, I know. Okay. All right, fine. Well, that's nice. Okay. John Calmer, Village Manager, Summer Celebration, thanks, which obviously there's many, but you have the floor.
Thank you, Your Honor. Actually, I have two items, and I apologize for not putting the other one on. The other is just a reminder about National Night Out coming up Tuesday, August 4th from 4 to 8 at Hartman Park. You'll see more information coming out with regards to this, but this is a great neighborhood opportunity for folks to come out, interact with the police department, lots of fun. And if you have a volleyball team that you would love to square off with the police department on, bring it on, as they say. With regards to Summer Celebration, I'll tell you what, this was as challenging an event as we've had in a number of years, and I, without a doubt, the committee, along with Public Works and the police and the Park District and everybody, really stepped up to the plate and did a wonderful job to present, you know, 4 days of festival. Mother Nature made it quite a challenge, and everybody really stepped up to the plate, and I give everybody a lot of credit and express a lot of appreciation for all their efforts. Thanks to the Summer Celebration Committee, co-chairs Kathy Zerillo and Joe Hoffman, Brandon and Jamie Adkins, Sue Hoffman, Tony Pastorino, Gretchen Grata, and Danielle Wells. These people have been working monthly since last fall, and we were meeting every week starting from the middle of June to the week before or the week of the event. So a lot of hard work, a lot of effort to present that great festival. Dozens of volunteers who checked IDs, served beer, sold popping water, and did a lot of things. A lot of kid volunteers. The Suchland boys were involved again this year and really did a fabulous job with that. Our corporate sponsors, obviously one of those was here tonight, American Hotel Register, CDW, the Taxman Corporation, Steinhoffel's, Worth Bear Supply, Medline Foundation, Tucson, and Rust-Oleum. Again, without their donations, it would be a lot more money that we would have to take out of the general fund to put on at a festival like this, and it's surely appreciated from all those folks. Had a lot of special banner sponsors and donors. A couple of highlighted ones, the Philly G's provided food for the VIP event that evening. Home Depot not only purchased a banner, but on Saturday, late in the afternoon, after we had received about 3 inches of rain in about 10 minutes, really stepped up to the plate and brought out some rolls of rubberized flooring that we were able to put down in front of the bar and under the tent. That made it a whole heck of a lot easier to get around on than it would have been otherwise. So a very big appreciation for their efforts there. And then Hits Pizza, very much appreciated all their food donations and the like over the event. I know that the volunteers and the police especially ate well because of Hits and everything that they provided. So Howard at A&Z Entertainment. Howard actually has worked this event for a number of years. Howard When we had the rain on Thursday, we were concerned that we were not going to get any music at all, and somebody put a call into Howard. Howard was not scheduled to work, and he came out, set all his equipment up, and started playing music under the tent and made, you know, what was a rainy, crappy evening much more enjoyable. So a big thanks to Howard. Another thanks goes out to the Lake County Sheriff's Department, Reserve Deputies. Talk about a force multiplier that really is a professional organization that really helped supplement our workforce, and especially with regards to traffic control and crowd maintenance and the like. So great job for those folks. Public Works Department, Pete and Mark and all their teams on the setup, Police Department and all their efforts. I can't imagine how it is wearing, you know, a 8 or 10 pound vest in 85 or 90 degree weather when it's 75% humidity and the like. So appreciate all their efforts. The Explorers, again, a lot of help from those folks. Park District for use of the grounds and their manpower contributions. They actually have people working that night, supplementing our public works forces to deal with anything on the grounds. Finally, a couple of internal folks in the finance department, Larry, obviously, and Nikki and their team for doing everything behind the scenes, tracking down the ATM, tracking down insurance certs, getting the checks ready, making the cash drawers ready, and everything like that. Without them, it doesn't work out in the field. So very much a lot of appreciation there. And then finally, somebody again behind the scenes, but key to the whole operation is Lynn DeAnda. She deals with the contracts and deals with the bands and all this stuff like this, and tracking down every little nitpicky thing that needs to be done that day. And again, without her efforts and her eye on detail and everything like that, this event is not nearly as successful as it is. So, and then finally, the other person, I left it off the list, Aaron Byrne McElroy, with her help and assistance with regards to the bands and working with the booking companies and the like. She's been a great advocate for the community and a great teacher for Jamie Adkins and everything like that. So very much appreciated for her efforts. She and I and Sean we were hunkered down in the entertainment trailer a Saturday while the wind was and the rain was blowing sideways. Finally, if there's anybody interested in the community that might be interested in serving on the committee or being a volunteer or something like that, you know, they can send me a letter or an email of interest. You can go on the website somersell.org and take a look there. I'm sorry, somersell.com, I should say. There's many opportunities, and again, if people are interested in serving, we would love to have you. So, and again, the other part of this, thanks to you all for the support. Without it, obviously, we don't have an event. So we appreciate everything that you allow us to do as a committee.
Yeah, and I just want to add, I thank all the same people. And, you know, I thanked a lot of people when I was announcing Lone Star. But with that said, Sunday, I actually got involved in the bags tournament. And I played with my daughter-in-law. But the important thing is that there was a lot of community participants.
Absolutely.
And a lot of camaraderie. Yep. And, you know, I don't know what you were playing for. What were you playing for? Blue ribbon or something? I don't know.
A couple coolers of beer, I think.
Maybe. And, who knows?
A few prizes.
There had to be, I don't know, 70, probably 100 people probably played because they were rotating them through to get it done. But the other thing was, it was a nice day as opposed to the first 3 days, and it was nice to see all the families out there and the kids, you know, having a nice time and, you know, people buying food from the vendors and coming back and sitting under the tent. And actually going into the tent, there was relief from the sun.
Yep.
It wasn't, you know, oppressive, and I don't know. I sat there for a while after I lost and just watched the world go by, and it was nice. So.
Yeah, it was a great day.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay. All right. Omnibus vote agenda. Is there a motion to approve items A through H?
So made.
Second.
Motion is second. Roll call, please.
I've got one question. It's just on F, and it's, I guess, directed to the deputy chief. This is the public radio system that will eliminate the ability for citizens to follow your activities via current scanner technology that's available to them?
That's correct. It's encrypted.
Right. And the date that this will become operational?
We believe, if everything goes according to plan, will be 1st January.
January 1. No more listening to police scanner calls. Good enough. That's all I wanted to get out there.
Okay. All right. So is there a motion and a second?
Yes.
Roll call.
Trustee Schultz?
Aye.
Trustee Marquardt?
Aye.
Trustee Cook?
Aye.
Trustee Schwartz?
Aye.
Trustee Williams? Trustee Hebda?
Aye.
Motion carries. Okay. Unfinished business, approval of camper voucher list of bills dated July 21st, 2015, in the amount of $17,389.79.
Motion to approve.
Second.
Motion is second. Comments or questions? If none, roll call.
Trustee Marquardt?
Aye.
Trustee Cook?
Aye.
Trustee Schwartz?
Abstain.
Trustee Williams? Trustee Hebda?
Aye.
Trustee Schultz?
Aye.
And for the record, I'd vote aye. Approval of village board minutes of July 7th, 2015. Is there a motion to approve?
Motion to approve.
Second.
Motion is second. Comments, questions, corrections, deletions? If none, roll call, please.
Trustee Cook?
Aye.
Trustee Schwartz?
Aye.
Trustee Williams? Trustee Hebda?
Aye.
Trustee Schultz?
Abstain.
Trustee Marquardt?
Aye.
Motion carries. New business communication, approval of, and passage of resolution 2015-133, a resolution authorizing approval of an intergovernmental agreement between the Village of Vernon Hills and the Vernon Hills Park District regarding the former OPA building and property at 950 Lakeview Parkway. Is there a motion to approve?
So made.
Second.
Motion is second. Comments, questions? If none, roll call.
Trustee Schwartz?
Aye.
Trustee Williams? Trustee Hebda?
Aye.
Trustee Schultz?
Aye.
Trustee Marquardt?
Aye.
Trustee Cook?
Aye.
For the record, I'd vote aye. Approval and passage of resolution 2015-134, a resolution authorizing assignment of the master power supply agreement between the Village of Vernon Hills and the Constellation New Energy, Inc. to its affiliate, Constellation Energy Services, Inc.
Motion to approve.
Second.
Motion is second. Comments or questions? Trustee Cook.
John, could you maybe explain that people might be getting something in the mail about this as it, and that it's just a name change? It really doesn't affect anything? Because I know the last time Constellation sent something out, there was some concern. I had a number of people call me questioning exactly what was going on with it.
I think you just did. Perfect. I'm not sure what else I can add there. Yeah, there is no change other than what Constellation is doing is, for all intents and purposes, streamlining their operation and integrating it into one brand, one newly named system. So from that standpoint, there's no change in the rates or terms of the current aggregation program whatsoever. So from that standpoint, they will get a letter that basically says this is a change. There's no other. They don't need to do anything. They don't need to. It's just information. And I think that will likely go out probably within the next 30 to 60 days. And it'll be just an information piece.
Yeah, it had no effect on your bill, your service delivery of the electricity. Okay, good. Thanks.
Trustee Marquardt.
I have a question. Are the gas company is now changing some things. Will they be starting to go into the gas companies now?
Again, there is no structure set up right now in state law that allows for an aggregation program similar to this, but it will eventually, I think, get there.
It's kicking.
The question will be is, where will gas prices be at that time, and can they make it competitive enough to be able to make it worthwhile to do? So.
Okay. Roll call.
Trustee Williams? Trustee Hebda?
Aye.
Trustee Schultz?
Aye.
Trustee Marquardt?
Aye.
Trustee Cook?
Aye.
Trustee Schwartz?
Aye.
Motion carries. Do we have to go into closed session tonight?
No, sir.
Okay. So is there a motion to adjourn the board meeting and go into committee of the whole?
So made.
Second.
Motion is second. Roll call, please.
Trustee Williams? Trustee Hebda?
Aye.
Trustee Schultz?
Aye.
Trustee Marquardt?
Aye.
Trustee Cook?
Aye.
Trustee Schwartz?
Aye.
Okay, motion carries. First item is approval of the committee of the whole meeting minutes of July 16th, 2015. Is there a motion to approve?
Motion to approve.
Second.
Motion is second. Comments, questions, corrections, deletions? If none, roll call, please.
Trustee Hebda?
Aye.
Trustee Schultz?
Aye.
Trustee Marquardt?
Aye.
Trustee Cook?
Aye.
Trustee Schwartz?
Aye.
Trustee Williams?
Motion carries. Request from Sue Cassett.
Could we maybe move item four up to the next
district?
Item? Well, we have, I think.
Okay, that, fine. Is that okay?
I would imagine that's why these folks are here, and if we could take care of residents.
Are you here for
the park district stuff?
For the kids?
For the kids' castle? Okay.
Okay.
We'll move you up first, okay?
What do you want to speak to us?
You want to come up and say something? No? Okay.
Well, then I'm not going to move it up. I'm only kidding.
Oh, no.
All right.
She's such a good girl. She's a good girl.
All right. We're going to, you know, change the agenda a little bit. Okay. Vern Hills Park District presentation of Kids Castle renovation plans.
Thank you for moving us up. We appreciate that. I am Amy Lamberti, and I am the community representative for the redesign and the change of Kids Castle. And as you can tell, it's not really me, it's our audience here who has been the most involved in the new design of our park. And we actually live in the Deer Pass subdivision, so we live on Cherokee Road. And this is our neighborhood park that we visit quite frequently. So I had gotten a phone call that had asked me if, from the community perspective, if I would help the redesign process and move it forward. And I was like, yes, this is great. So as we look at what historically has been there, it really is a treasure. And it's a landmark that many people hold dear in their hearts. And we hope to continue to instill that same process that we had previously. So the first thing that we've done is we were in the Vernon Hills Parade, and we were able to pass out flyers. And that was a really great opportunity to bring awareness to our community. And then through the weeks, we've been putting it at different places throughout the community. So we had it at the pool. It was also over at the Lakeview Fitness Center. And I've been getting emails from people saying, oh, this is such a great thing. We definitely want to support this process. How can we get involved? So that's been really good news for us. The other piece of this too is we're doing a brick purchase. And a lot of people have been saying, we're going to buy a brick for our family, for our, you know, team sports that we're part of. And we're slowly but surely starting to begin that process of raising money for our designs. So thank you for the support from the village as well as from the park district for our future park attendees here, because they're very excited about what's to come and have been very involved in the process. So we're looking at the teardown to be late October. And I have created a Google form where the community can sign up using a tinyurl.com/VHKidsCastle. That can also be found on the Vernon Hills Park District website. So people can go on to the form, fill out their information with their phone number and their email. And then from there, we're able to communicate out the process of late October being the teardown. And then we will do hopefully the rebuild and have it launched by May of 2016. We do have, we've had quite a bit of communication from the community about people that previously have purchased bricks. You know, if I've purchased bricks previously, are they going to not put those in the new design? So I've been reassuring the community that nope, the bricks will be back in to the new design. We'll shine them up and put them in with the new purchased bricks. We're also in the process of building communication with community relationships, business partnerships, local sponsors. So that's kind of been something we're trying to get involved with too. So do you guys have any questions or thoughts or concerns or anything you want to know from the kids about the process? Because they'll tell you. They got to help.
So you're using volunteers to tear it down, and then is a company coming in to put it all up?
The Park District is going to sponsor and support that process, as well as the community and the builders, of tearing down and rebuilding. There are certain things that, as the community, you know, we can't be part of because of safety measures. So we'll get as far as we can with community support, and then from there, the Park District will come in. Oh,
so they'll be involved in both the tear down and the rebuild?
Yes.
Oh, okay.
Yes. That's the hope.
So. Trustee Cook?
Yeah, I just wanted to say that when it originally came up and we were talking about how old the park was getting, initial discussions, some people thought were just to tear it down and turn it back into a regular park. And I'm really happy to see that there's been enough interest to be able to produce a new one to replace the old one, and it's very good news.
Yeah, thank you. And we've tried to keep some element, obviously, as you can see, it still has that castle theme. And Jeff and I have talked about ways that we can continue with some of the historical components to build it into the future design. So for example, there's the big dragon that somebody created back 17 years ago, you know, being able to take taking that dragon and just shining it up a bit and repainting it and using that as a landmark to say, you know, Kids Castle 1,000 feet, and then taking the fire truck and putting that in the parking lot, you know, Kids Castle 800 feet, and slowly but surely making it a little museum display. So as people pull in, because there are pieces there that kids have said, oh my gosh, I built that, I made that, you know, when I was.
All those ideas came from, we sent out a flyer and the school was nice enough to put it in all the kids' backpacks. So they got the information that we were trying to do this and we wanted ideas and we needed help. And so we had a big meeting one night. We had like 300 people show up, and they came up with all these ideas of wanting. The kids said, I want a fire truck, I want a dragon. And then we just tried to put that into the playground. And then that's also how we started at least getting some of the volunteers that we needed to help.
Well, the design process did come from, you know, I had all the books and magazines, and all the neighborhood kids would come over and I'd have play dates with the parents, and we'd sit at my front table and I'd say, circle what you like. Tell me what you think here is something that we need to have. So we've been trying to replicate that same process of really truly making it a community park. And, you know, I've been active on social media within the Vernon Hills Facebook page for moms, asking people for their input and their ideas and thoughts too. So we're still trying to keep that old piece of it being a community park.
And this will all be basically recycled materials.
The new playground?
New one, yeah.
No, it's not, it's all new.
Yeah, I know. Not wood recycled materials, I know that.
Yeah.
But I mean, this is all kind of, you know, plastic.
State of the art, yeah, right. Fiber.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, that's fine. Yeah,
there was two different companies that we had looked at, and one was much more plasticky feeling, and we ended up going with the one that had higher quality to bring some longevity to the park. So
it's engineered wood?
It's a fiberglass model. The other things, too, we wanted to make sure in the design that it's going to be completely accessible. And so what you see here is all poured in place, so no wood chips on the site, so that it's, you know, it's available for all.
So it's going to be rubber,
all label
falling.
Right.
Yeah.
Kid takes a header, it'll just be a tire imprint.
That's it.
Yeah, I was going to ask the question if it was handicap accessible for kids too.
Yeah,
I'd like to know from the kids, what's your favorite part of this, Charlotte? What's the favorite piece? Come up and tell me what you're going to like about this the most. Charlotte's a former preschool student, very smart young lady. What do you think's going to be the best part?
State your complete name, your home address,
tell us
and your age.
And your address.
And where were you born?
I'm Charlotte. I live on Cherokee Road. And
how old are you?
I'm 9. And my favorite part of the playground is going to be the zipline.
Zipline.
Oh. Yay. Yeah.
So we've got a zip cruiser in here. That was a hot item that the kids kept saying, we want a zip line. So lo and behold, the park district listened.
How far is that off the elevator? How high?
I think it's 12. Is it 12 feet if I remember correctly? So it's, yeah.
It's about 40 to 50 feet.
Is it 40 to 50 feet?
I mean, long. But how high is it off the ground?
Off the ground? I think it's about 7 or 8 feet off.
Okay.
Yeah. Shows 12 feet.
What's your favorite, Dylan?
In case somebody takes a header.
Tell us your name and where you live.
I'm Dylan Smith. I live in 16 Cherokee Road. And I think my favorite part about the new park is the rock that you can climb on.
Climbing rock?
Mm-hmm. The canyon rock climber.
Yep. That's right in through, let's see here. Right here. Yep. The canyon rock climber.
Okay.
And that was something we kept hearing is, you know, kids go over to Castle Park because they like the hide-and-go-seek piece of it.
Thank you. Oh, look,
so,
Roger.
Yep, you guys are matching.
What, are you trying to upstage me? What are you, you know.
He's got the, yeah, same one. No.
What do you, what's the matter with your wrist?
What'd you do? Here.
What?
Oh, I was playing soccer and I was goalie and I passed it to my friend and I took one step back and never knew my suit was untied. I fell back and broke my wrist.
You fell back?
Yeah. At the week you break school it? Ended, mind you. So this
yeah.
Well, that's good. Everybody should break a bone in their childhood. What's your name, please?
Tommy.
Tommy what?
Lamberti.
Okay.
And what's your address?
18 Cherokee Road.
You related to anybody here?
My mom?
Yeah. Okay. We got the truth out of him.
Yeah. So what's your favorite
go ahead.
Part? Oh, my favorite part is that it's dark colors, not light colors, because if it's light colors, you can't really play hide and seek and stuff.
They like the they didn't want all the reds and the blues, the primary look. They wanted still those.
Okay. So. Well, thank you. And hopefully you recover from your injury.
We're on the route.
Because I'm guessing you're going to recover a lot quicker than me.
Well, I don't know. It was a good break. So, and that's the third break, by the way. And
he's
only 8.
Same hand?
Nope.
Oh.
Nope. So I got a few.
We break another hand or a foot?
I got a football player in my hand, so there's more breaks to come.
Oh, yeah.
So,
yeah.
So the plan is to tear it all down in October and then rebuild it so that it's open by May?
Mid to late May is when we'll coordinate all the efforts to construct the new playground. Yeah.
Cool.
Should take probably about a 10-day to 2-week process. Mm-hmm. Again, up to Amy and her volunteers and scheduling that with park staff. And
sure.
We may call Dave for a little assistance. but just to, you know, do it almost round the clock, maybe get some portable lights out there and make it an event that, you know, like when Gene, when you and Rick, you know, organized that some 20 years ago, and just get the community all involved in that once again.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And I've had great support so far. So.
All right, so what's the price tag?
Right now, this is about $550,000, what you see there.
Yeah.
An average playground in today's effort is about $100,000. We're going to be redoing Grosse Pointe and Peterson Park playgrounds this fall, and those are about anywhere from $75,000 to $100,000. So this is about a 12,000 square foot footprint. Most of the other playgrounds are a fifth of that.
Yeah.
Yeah. So
space.
The port in place is a couple hundred thousand just alone. Yeah.
So you can put it in. Good project.
It's a great project.
Yep. Thank you. It's been fun. So thank you for your support. We appreciate that.
Thank
you. So you're chasing donations.
Yes, we are, Mayor. Best we can. Yeah. That's what.
Not just from us.
Not just from you. No.
So who are you really chasing?
She's you can answer that.
We've got the brick components right now, but you know, a lot of times just sitting and talking to people, and you start talking about it, and you find out they work at AbbVie, or you know, they're at Hewitt, or they're CDW, and you're like, hey, do you got anybody you could put me in contact with? So I was actually just on the phone last week with somebody who gave me a lead with someone through CDW. So, but I know we also have someone through the Park District who has relationships with people as well. So,
are you like maybe we did sponsoring a piece? Each piece had a price tag on it, and you could sponsor that piece, and then they'd be recognized on the board.
Yeah.
So, like, you know, if Rust-Oleum or something wanted to buy a certain piece, it would cost this much money, and that's mm-hmm. how we got the bigger amounts of money.
Yeah.
Because do you have any money?
Thank you to the Park District. They're going to put through the grant, which, when did we find out about that?
It'll probably later this year. Yeah.
And how much would that be?
That grant's for $400,000. But that includes not only the playground that we're redoing, because we're master planning the park. So this is one component. We're redoing the 6 tennis courts, and we're redoing ball fields 3 and 4 with all new, you know, fencing, backstop, dugouts. So, and then we're also going to be redoing some of the walk path from where Lake County just completed that project up through 45 here. So we're going to be going north with doing.
So how much money out of this grant?
The budget on everything, Mayor, is about $1.2 million. So the grant is $400,000.
Well, so how much are you guys putting into this?
$900,000 is what we have allocated for our master plan.
But it didn't answer my question. I'm talking about the kids' castle playground.
Well, right now we're at $550,000 of the $900,000. We're going to be dedicating $550,000.
Okay, and then in hopes of getting some. Okay,
really
correct.
And you want to start this in the fall?
No, we're going to...
Spring
of 16.
Okay.
Is when this is all going to start, yeah.
Okay.
The time frame for our staff to get in and demo it is best in late fall than it is in spring, because we get too busy to take on something.
Why don't you give your contact information to John?
John and I actually had a meeting. So we've already been in communication.
I know, but John
got some leads for us, John.
John doesn't shake the bush like I do. You catch on?
Yes.
Got it.
That, you know.
Okay. We're open to anybody who wants to fly money our way. We'll take it.
Yeah, well, sometimes you got to tickle them, you know.
Or take the kids to the door and have them knock.
No, this ain't this ain't knocking on doors at houses.
Right? This is in Trick or Treat. We say, Kids Castle, you got some money for us?
Yeah. This is kind of going to a higher level.
So.
Okay. What else? Is that about it?
That's it.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Very much.
Thank you.
All right.
Thank you for your time.
Okay. Well, thank you.
Now you guys can go home and play. All right.
They want to stay in.
Or you want to stay? No, you don't want to stay. No.
Take care.
Good job.
Hi. Okay, what else? Anything? Request from Sukasa. Are you here, Sukasa? Okay. To amend ordinance 2004-034, providing facade renovations at 561 North Milwaukee Avenue.
Mr. Mayor, as they're setting up, they're going to set up the color elevations for you. This pertains to the outdoor dining terrace on the east side of the restaurant. They would be replacing what is now a canvas covering with a permanent enclosure. The enclosure would be made of a masonry base around the perimeter. There'd be aluminum framing with glazed panels that would extend up from the knee wall over the terrace, forming the roof and then connecting to the existing building. And in just a moment now. They'll show you what it looks like. And that elevation they're giving you right now gives you a good idea of what it looks like. So again, that permanent enclosure, which consists of brick at the base, aluminum framing and glazed panels extending up from the masonry base, mm-hmm. as a roof and extending to the existing building, would replace the canvas covering. The space would continue to be used as dining. Staff, in looking at it, believes that the design is consistent with the architecture of the building and is generally supportive of it. We do wish to note for you, though, that Ordinance 2004-034, which approved the original special use permit and site plan for Tsukasa, contained conditions in it that limited seating based on parking. And part of that pertained to the outdoor terrace. Cutting to the chase, if they want to enclose the outdoor terrace, they need to demonstrate that they have a cross parking agreement with the property owner of what is now Steinhoffel's property. We've been informed that that agreement is in fact in place. It's just a matter of the village getting a copy of the agreement and reviewing it and having it in our files. Staff is recommending that getting that agreement be made a condition of the approval. Again, the color elevations, in addition to what are in front of you, are attached to your packet. And for tonight, if the board feels that the renovation and enclosure is appropriate, then staff should be directed to prepare an ordinance, amending Ordinance 2004-034, approving the facade renovations subject to the conditions that are outlined in your packet. And representatives of Tsukasa are here to answer any questions that you might have.
Yeah, go ahead, Trustee Schultz.
Biggest question I got is I'm looking at my minutes and my tablet, mm-hmm. and I don't know, can you see?
Yes.
What do you see?
I see the rendering of the Tsukasa. There's one slight alteration that the owner actually wanted, was to lower the brick wall to have glazing at the lower portion.
Yeah, and that's exactly what I'm seeing too. That's a big greenhouse now. I don't like it. I like what you originally put and what you gave me originally. That just looks like a greenhouse. I'm all in favor of allowing him to do it. I took advantage of his little patio early last winter while I was dining there, and it's a great space, but that's ugly. This is marginally acceptable. So I can't vote for that. I can vote for this.
Okay, I can discuss the alteration.
Which one are you voting for?
Well, yeah, I agree with what Jim, I agree too. I want what
he brought
there.
Is different than what you've got, right?
Well,
the brick wall.
When you're sitting, yeah. I don't know how tall are the chairs and the tables. If you're sitting with this brick wall, can you see out or no?
Oh, I see. Oh, yeah. I catch on. Yeah.
The rendering we have here, the sill, the bottom of the glazing is just a few inches above the existing platform, whereas the one that you have in your hands there, it is basically 36 inches above. That is really the
so you can see out, because the average seat is 18 inches, yeah, and the average human is a good 25 to 35 inches from waist above. So you can see out with the brick, over the brick.
Yeah.
Oh, so if you have this original plan with the brick and you're sitting in there, you can see out?
You can.
Okay.
Because the seating is fairly close to it, you can see out. Basically, at 36 inches, when you're sitting down, it'd roughly be around here, depending on your physical build. So you would still be able to see out. This gives greater clarity with this plan, and you're also able to see into.
How much of a savings is it?
To lower the wall?
To do glass instead of the wall.
Good question.
There must be some savings. I don't know.
I'm sure there is.
I don't think there's going to be that much of a savings.
There's more to increase the visibility in and out of the space.
I don't know that the savings is really an issue, because we're replacing more construction brick and whatnot. With glass, glass is expensive, brick is cheaper, but there's more construction. I don't know that it's a big deal. This is what the owner, when shown this, this is what he preferred. He wanted more glass, so it stands out. So he, you know, when you're inside that room, it's all glass. Mm-hmm. Pretty much like what you have here.
Is there maybe a different color instead of the stark white that would lessen that, and you just see more glass and not really see all this white that's there?
I think the owner would be open to that. There was some discussion of maybe going a dark color similar to the brick, maybe a bronze or something along those lines. That shouldn't be an issue.
That would work for me.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That would reduce this, you know, look of the greenhouse type thing.
Okay.
What are you saying? Make it
the white,
perhaps darker.
Darker on the bottom area.
Brown or reddish brown to mm-hmm. match the brick.
Match the brick.
That's doable.
And you know, how is this is going to be now fully heated and air conditioned?
It's still not a conditioned space. The windows are primarily operable. Half of them are operable, the other fixed. So it'll pretty much be open when it's a nice day like it is today. But when you get more temperate times, or if there's a heavy downpour like we had last Saturday, they can close it up and people can still eat without having to relocate to a different seat.
So which windows will open? I mean, these ceiling windows?
Yeah, it essentially would be every other one.
The open. Ceiling?
No,
not the ceiling.
Every other one of these will open.
Yeah. Like a sliding door, then technically.
Right, a big slide by window is what it is. Yeah, like a patio door. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Worry about anything, the curb jump of a vehicle? A car jumping over a curb mm-hmm. and?
Well, the first thing I hit is the 18 inches of brick wall.
Mm-hmm.
So,
or putting a brick wall in?
It's well, just that small.
Oh, it's 18 inches.
I thought you were 36. Okay.
Plus a 6 to 8 inch curb.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. It'd have to be one heck of a jump to make it.
It's doable.
I've seen them.
Oh, you got a lot of big RVs or SUVs pulling in there.
That's true.
You know. Yeah. Trustee Schwartz.
No, my comments were already made.
Then, Mike, would you like a motion then to direct staff to prepare the ordinance you were talking about, subject to when it comes back at board level, we would get to see new drawings that would.
Yeah, what we could do is, I think, subject to the conditions that you discussed tonight, which is if a darker window frame color, something that matches the brick better, and if in the motion, if you can be clear as to the brick wall, if you were okay with the 18-inch height or the 36-inch height, and then we could bring revised color elevations back to you at a future meeting, put it on unfinished business so you get another look at it.
Okay.
And we'd have a draft ordinance prepared for that meeting as well.
Safety issue, that's all. How big a deal do you think the safety is, Mike, on 18 versus 36?
Compromise at 24?
Well, you're going into a brick wall, it's a little sturdier of it, but it's just a protection, that's all I'm looking at, so. You can frame it differently too. So,
all right. Well, do we have a consensus on the 18-inch wall versus the 36?
36 versus 18. I'm fine with it.
Or maybe compromise at like 24. I mean, that would be.
Yeah,
that would provide an extra six inches of security in terms of a car. So
we could, if safety is a concern, we could have it increase the height to 24 like you suggested, fill the block solid, and then reinforce it so that if it gets hit, it's going to stay pretty solid.
Okay.
For them. We could make that a condition of it.
Okay, then I'll make that motion.
Second
it. Yeah.
Motion is second. So it's okay. It's the reinforce the wall And then to change and raise it to 24, and then to change the color to?
Match the brick more.
Okay.
And the five things that are in our.
It could be a bronze.
And then you'd want to make sure you adjust, just to make sure that that one railing, or whatever you want to call it, that's going through the upper and lower glass isn't at your eyesight view when you're sitting. That's the worst thing I hate. I sit on a patio, and then there's, you know, I can't see the view, so.
Understand.
Okay.
You like parking lots.
Not
right?
That's a great view, but.
Right. Wait for that one.
Yeah.
The flowers at Home Depot in the spring.
Very nice to look at.
Yeah, okay. All right, so we have a motion and a second.
Yes.
If there's no further comments or questions, roll call, please.
Trustee Marquardt?
Aye.
Trustee Cook?
Aye.
Trustee Schwartz?
Aye.
Trustee Williams? Trustee Hebda?
Aye.
Trustee Schultz?
Aye.
Motion carries. Okay, we'll see you maybe in August. My super fast pizza.
Yeah.
Hear it.
Thank you, Your Honor. Mata Pizza appeared before the Planning and Zoning Commission meeting on July 15th to present their plans for a fast casual restaurant serving alcohol at 701 North Milwaukee Avenue. Specifically, they're looking to lease 2,900 square feet of space at the location on the eastern portion of the property. That's adjacent to the DXL in the Rivertree Court Shopping Center. What Mod Pizza really is it's a fast casual restaurant, similar to Chipotle, except they're obviously heating their food in a super hot oven. It typically takes about 5 or 6 minutes to cook a pizza. They're served in two different sizes, and then you have as many toppings as you want as you move forward. They've got currently, they're initially a Washington-based company, but now I have two locations in the Chicago area, one being in Naperville and the other one just opening up in Deerfield. They're all dining in service or to go. In addition, they're also proposing outdoor dining, which would require an outdoor dining license at a later date. In addition to those items, they're also proposing to serve beer and wine at the counter, which necessitates a special use permit, as well as a liquor license at a later date. The Planning and Zoning Commission reviewed this and unanimously approved the recommendation for special use, as well as two variations, one involving parking to allow a variation for 19 spaces. The total parking lot has 48 spaces, but due to the parking calculation requirements for both DXL and Mod Pizza, they'll need that additional space or variation. They are in negotiations with Inland, which is the owner of the shopping center to the east, for a shared parking agreement. But due to them still working through that, we want to, the Planning and Zoning Commission recommended the variation in case that didn't happen to go through. In addition to that, there was also a sign variation, and that was for the east elevation, so pointing more towards the shopping center, and that's a variation of 9.36 square feet. So again, the Planning and Zoning Commission unanimously approved it. However, the Committee of the Whole feels that the request is appropriate. It is recommended that staff be directed to prepare the necessary ordinance granting approval to the following. Approval of special use to allow a restaurant serving alcohol with the following variations. To allow a sign variation for the wall sign on the east elevation to be 29.55 square feet, a 9.36 square feet variation. Secondly, to allow a parking variation to allow 48 parking spaces in lieu of the minimum number of spaces required, which is 67, which combines the retail component and the restaurant component. And finally, with the preliminary and final site and landscaping plan approvals, as well as preliminary and final approvals for architectural elevations. The petitioner is here today to answer any questions. Otherwise, these items would be subject to conditions of approval that are outlined in your packet.
Any questions? That's why I want you up here. I don't, you know.
No problem.
Now, you want to state your name for the record?
Yes, my name is David Zimmerman, and I'm the construction manager for Mod Pizza. I'm based here in Chicago. Mod Pizza is out of Seattle. It's about a six-year-old company, and Chicago is one of the markets that they've chosen, as well as Milwaukee, Madison, St. Louis here in the Midwest. Probably going to open 50 to 60 over the next 5 to 6 years is what our
goal is. Somebody from Seattle thinks they can make pizza?
Yes, they do. Yes, they do. It's actually one of a few competitors. Blaze is another concept. You've probably, or possibly if you've been downtown, they're located downtown. Pie 5 is another one. It's all the fast casual, quick type pizza. You walk through the line, you determine what toppings you want on your pizza, and then we put it in the brick oven to cook it, 750 degrees, 5 to 6 minutes. We call your name, either pick it up to take it back to your table or take it to go. No delivery. Pizza, our pizza's best to either eat or take it to go, but delivery, we haven't thought about that yet.
Trustee Cook.
Couple things. The outdoor seating area. Mm-hmm. Staff said earlier you do not allow any of the alcohol outside. No. What we've seen in Chicago, in the Chicago suburbs, I should say, is that alcohol is not allowed to be taken on the patios, which okay. We're fine with. In the Northwest, it's not an issue. But here, I shouldn't say an issue.
Well, just know that if you were to do that, you would have to enclose that. For one thing, you'd have to enclose that front area, you know, to the patio so that you could only go in and out of the building.
Can they take it out in the Northwest?
Yes, on the patios. Yes. Okay. We can in Texas as well.
And then they can have some medicinal stuff?
Yeah. Okay. Yeah, alcohol is the least of the concerns out there.
Because everything's legal there, right?
Yes.
So you can go have a beer and a smoke.
Yes. Yes.
And the other question I had, I forget who I talked to earlier, the one change in this property is the elimination of the driveway, at least part of it, to put the patio there. So the whole building is fine with being able to.
Yes, the DXL is fine with it. The building owner actually wants it. He wants to really try to freshen that little building up. It's yeah. Pretty boring, pretty tired. So he's looking to actually, you know, put some money in it, which is great.
Okay. And what's your hours of operation?
Basically, let's see, Sunday through Thursday is like 10 a.m. to 9 p.m. And then Friday and Saturday, we're open till 10 o'clock at night.
Yeah. So you figure you're going to be able to use parking where the clothing store is?
Yeah.
And that's, well, of course, Inland can work that out, right?
And that's the thing. I guess a few years ago, Payway was looking to go in the same space.
Payway. Little brother, P.F. Chang.
Yeah, okay. The fast casual of P.F. Chang. And, okay. And they had that agreement in place, the building owner did with Inland at that time. So they really don't see an issue with getting the same for us now. Okay. Payway backed out of the deal, so it fell apart, but they did get it back at that time.
Yeah, okay. We don't really have a pizza joint in town. Right? I mean, to go
well,
sit in.
Giordano's.
Oh, Giordano's. Yeah,
that's it.
Yeah, Giordano's, I guess, is right around
but
the corner.
It's
in the
right stretch. Around the corner.
I know though, he came in the last 2 years. That's yeah. True. Mm-hmm.
It's a little bit different. It's a little bit different.
Right, it is different.
And it's only thin crust. That's all. We do have a gluten-free crust as well, but it's very thin crust. Obviously, to bake it is quick. All the ingredients, or I should say the sausage and so forth, are all pre-cooked. Basically, we are reheating it, but it's the chicken's all pre-cooked and everything. So that's the other reason why it can cook so quick. And alcohol is about 4 to 5% of our sales. It's more a convenience to have for mom and dad if they want to relax.
Yeah, okay. Well, I mean, staff, is there any outstanding issues here with the traffic pattern and the parking and...
No, we've reviewed...
I'm not asking him, I'm asking staff.
If you're asking the police department, we wouldn't have a problem.
No concerns from traffic circulation, Joe might talk about the parking.
And then the entrance is kind of where it is now?
Yeah, correct.
Okay.
It's all staying.
Trustee Hebden.
Is this metal or what is this on the front?
That's wood, so it's...
And then your sign, you have backlit bulbs, are those white or are they the colored ones?
They're white bulbs.
They're white.
I don't...
Okay. Oh, they're, okay, that's a better picture. Okay.
So it's not, so it's not multi...
That's actually a picture of one in the northwest.
It's a multicolor, it's, it backlits, but this is wood up here. This kind of reminds me of what Pier One has too. Oh, I see, there's, okay.
Yeah, so it's just cedar. Stained cedar.
Okay.
And again, the property owner really wanted us to do something different. They didn't want to just see more ephes.
Do you need to have the super fast up there?
That's part of our logo, the super fast.
Yeah, I mean, it's okay, but...
Mm-hmm. Super, and I know you start thinking, but that's one of the things that does the pizzas.
Yeah.
So that's one of the...
Yeah. But that's the, okay, so that's the materials, okay.
Yeah.
Okay. And that'll go all the way around?
It's going to go on the two...
On the top elevation.
On the top elevation.
Correct.
What's the depth of the space?
It's 2,900 square feet.
I said the depth.
The depth.
I know the square footage. You know, you walk in the door, how many feet is it before you hit the wall that's contiguous to the clothing store?
The clothing store's next, so you're walking in, the clothing store is over on this side, so you're walking into our space here.
Well, you got the space that was the telephone store.
Right.
It could be, okay.
And so it's the whole space?
Yes.
So when I walk in a door, I'm going to be, if I walk straight back, I'm going south.
You're going north towards...
You're going north.
North, the entranceway is on the south.
The entrance...
Yes. Wait a second. So is the clothing store leaving?
No.
No, it's on the same side as the entrance is on the same side as the entrance to the clothing store. It's on the south side.
Okay, so the clothing, what was the total square footage, 10,000 there? When it was...
Yeah, the clothing store has
no
horizon.
Okay, now I capisce. Yeah, that was about 10,000 square feet, so the clothing store must have about 7. If this is 3. Well, right, I mean, okay, all right, fine. That's kind of interesting, yeah. All right, well, so there's no issue with the parking?
That's correct.
Okay. I don't have any further questions. Is the board?
No.
Motion to approve that?
Okay.
I'll make a motion to approve based on the recommendations from P&Z.
And direct the staff.
And direct staff to draw up an ordinance.
Okay, there's a motion. Is there a second?
Second.
No further comments or questions. A roll call.
Trustee Cook?
Aye.
Trustee Schwartz?
Aye.
Trustee Williams? Trustee Hebda?
Aye.
Trustee Schultz?
Aye.
Trustee Marquardt?
Aye.
When do you expect to be open?
Motion carries.
Right now, we'd like to be open before the Christmas shopping. So Thanksgiving would be what we're pushing for.
Yeah. Be smart to open when the school's open because I think you'll get a lot of students over there if it's fast pizza.
Yeah, and that's what we're hoping to get a lot of students in as well.
Yeah.
It's about a nine-week build. And so once we get our permits, we're ready to go as soon as we get the permits. Okay. We can't get open soon enough, that's for sure.
But. Pending ordinance approval, we're currently tentatively scheduling a liquor license hearing for September the 15th.
So what's the space that actually was AT&T? Is that 10,000 square feet?
Verizon.
Whatever. I mean, yeah, okay, well, yeah. But I mean, how many square feet was that use? Because they did have the whole north side. So how does...
It may have been half the space. It may have been half the building.
So is that building 20,000 square feet?
No, no, I don't believe so.
It's about 11,000. So DXL is somewhere around 8, and then this place is somewhere around 3, give or take.
I understand that, but what there's the others where Verizon was, or
so ADXL is with it. The
did
footprint
go all the way to the back.
Yeah, the footprint of DXL is kind of interesting because it runs through the north side.
Yeah, because you can't even.
Then also it takes place
in.
Primarily on the western portion of the
okay.
property.
Yeah, yeah. Okay. All right. So that was divided. All right. All right. Fine. So we don't have a worry about another tenant coming in.
No.
Two.
All right. Yeah. Okay.
Yeah.
All right.
Thank you.
Okay. Thank you.
Take care.
Thank you.
Now the light show. What are we doing to the light show?
Thank you very much. Approximately 30 days ago at a board meeting, made a previous presentation, received some really good feedback from the board. So took that to heart, looked at different opportunities. So I wanted to propose a new vision on where we may head. In terms of the existing light show, it served us well for many years. The feedback that I received from the board is we want to do something a little bit different. We want it throughout the whole village. So we're doing a multi-prong attack in terms of it. We're going to include public buildings, entry monuments, a community outreach has already started, and we've looked at our banners and our light poles. So we've also, you know, reviewed our infrastructure as far as what light poles have outlets, what we can plug into, and so that'll be built into my presentation. So really wanted to go through our public buildings first, so we'll walk through one after the other. So existing public buildings, the Village Hall, we light our building currently for the holiday, and also Municipal Golf Course. I've heard really good feedback in terms of those two. Municipal Golf Course, we want to add more color to the holiday tree, so we'll make that adjustment. Also in terms of the animatronic golfer, that will be included in our plan for the Muni. The Metro Station, we've outlined the building before, and we want to add a little bit more lighting to the building itself. There's also a berm, and we have electricity for when we set up Oktoberfest. Presents an opportunity. What we'd like to do there is there's a number of evergreen trees. We'd like to light that and extend that berm because we're already doing something at the Metro Station. So I think that addresses our 45 corridor pretty good. We have something at the Village Hall, the golf course, and the Metro Station. In talking with the chief, the police facilities, especially along Phillip Road, I think that presents a good opportunity. We'll show you a slide of that area, but there is a nice canvas that we can add some lighting along Phillip, certainly. Public Works, similar opportunity on Butterfield Road. We can add some of the displays that we currently have at Cuneo, and we'll add that. We've talked to Jeff Steingart. In terms of the fire department, he's receptive to us working with them. Also, I still need to approach the church and see if they will piggyback that concept southerly across their frontage too. So that's still on my radar screen, and we're reaching out to the community. So, you know, here's an example of, we have existing outlets for the police building, so we can plug into the outside outlets, and here's, you know, a couple of the snowmen that we can put at the police facility. Looking at our public works building, something similar to this, we've got the skaters, we've got the waterfall skating scene also. That's something that we have the capacity to, electrical capacity to achieve. Fire department, there's some trees in that area. We thought the deers might be a good representative for in front of their building.
Could we put the leaping deers like right where, you know, the entrance to White Deer Run is, so that everybody can enjoy them as they drive up and down Greg's Parkway. The Leaping Deer.
The Leaping Deer. I know which ones they are. I'm trying
to
think.
Don't look at me like you don't know what those are.
I know what those are. I'm trying to think the electrical needs for that. But.
Might put them up against the backside of the driving range.
No, I actually put them up there when you come up by Mariano's and that other place. You can just
leap over the arch.
Leap over the arch, yeah. Up there.
Yeah, we know there's electricity there.
Isn't there electricity there?
Is the other place, you know, what's the name of it?
Menards.
Oh, Menards, yeah.
But there's their entrance into Red Landing. Yeah.
So you're talking about over the roadway?
Well, no, over the
they
arch.
They have Greg's Landing.
The arch itself.
Yeah.
I'm just, you know, because it's White Deer Run.
Yeah, I agree with the man. I think it would be better over the entrance to the White golf course.
Or yeah. Somewhere near there.
Yeah.
Because it's
yeah.
not big enough for yeah. that full driveway entrance, no. is it?
No, dear.
Because the road where people used to go in to see the light show, that was a narrower road.
Yes.
So,
yes.
Trustee Hebney, are you suggesting putting it over the entrance monument into right. Greg's Landing? Right. Not over the road itself, but over
no,
the monument?
The entrance monument.
Okay.
So. Is there electricity there?
Yeah, we yes. cut those gears.
Of course, there's yeah. lights there.
Yeah. Yes, there is.
I don't know what you put there, but if there's electricity, there might be some possibility of putting some lighting there.
I like that. Let me pursue that concept.
There's another gateway into mm-hmm. our
You probably have to work with the HOA.
Absolutely.
And at the other end, too, in front of the waterfall.
Right. Which... I don't know.
Yes, and in the presentation, you'll see we've got some opportunities at the Butterfield Road side, too, so that will be included. Yeah.
And again, the backside of the driving range there, that's a pretty blank canvas that you might, and it's far enough off the roadway that it shouldn't be tampered with, but then again, you know, it gives you an opportunity to potentially use some of the stuff we have that is far from good, but good from far.
Point well taken. So, yeah, thank you for those two recommendations, direction.
Thank you for your further input.
Yeah. Unless we can partner with someone from each of those facilities, we'll talk to White Deer Run. Could they, when they come in, could they be the ones to do it? If not, we'll do it.
So. Timers, but the problem is that GFI faults if they get wet.
Yeah. Right.
Yeah. Yeah. This is going to be a really learning curve as far as, you know, we're fearful because we hear from other maintainers on what they've been faced with. We're going into it and we'll put the energy into it to make it successful. And we're going to learn for the following year where we have
right.
been or haven't been
right.
successful.
Okay. You know, we could probably do, we should do something at the northeast corner of 60 and 21.
Absolutely. I'm one slide before that one. Golf and Butterfield Road. Not a really good picture, but we do have electricity here. We think we can outline the brick and we can add some running light in the front LED and it'll light it up. So that's an opportunity that we're pursuing. And the very front cover photo shows what we actually do at Route 60 in the Des Plaines River. I think it's done very well. I think the next step to enhance it is we have the evergreen trees in the back. If we have sufficient electrical power, we're going to end up wrapping those trees. We think we do have the power.
You know, it might be time to bring back Frosty.
And maybe Frosty can go at the northeast corner of 60 and 21 again.
See if somebody glams it again, huh? Yeah. The caper.
Again, the corpus delicti was not found
Mick
in our time.
Remembers that, right? That was probably good for attendance. Found it in the trunk of a big old Cadillac.
Was it in the station wagon?
In
what was it?
In Lincolnshire.
Do I exaggerate?
They like your station wagon.
Where'd they find?
He was covered at a gas station over in Lincolnshire.
And what kind of car?
I don't remember the car.
Well, it could be a big Cadillac.
It could be whatever car you want.
Momo's car.
Moving on.
Thank you. So we showed the public buildings. We've showed some entry monuments. So we're starting to fill in and around the village. Community outreach, I talked, talked to Chief Steingart. So Deer Path and the church is being pursued. John was helpful with reaching out to Westfield. So we are meeting with them, and we'll have more discussions.
Right. Well, it would make, it would kind of make sense to the retailers. Jeez. Yeah.
Absolutely, absolutely. Yeah. American Hotel Register, we sent an email to them. Didn't want to bring it up during their proclamation today, but we will be pursuing that further. Half-day intersection, so we'll be talking to the new owners, the non-taxmen at that corner.
Who bought Smolders?
John?
Partnership.
Do we know?
Not off the top of my head. But we have the contact information.
Okay.
Was that in the last year now?
Yeah. They bought a majority of the commercial with the exception of the mixed-use building.
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
So there has been emails with them. They're waiting for their staff to come back. They have two different people that are helping with that. They're looking to do something similar that they did last year, and potentially we can enhance it from there. So.
Okay.
Frosty, northeast corner, 60 and 21, it's an opportunity. And we've also partnered at the northwest corner of 60 and Lakeview. So across from Wendy's, they have their monument sign. We can add some lights on their evergreen trees and work with them at that corner. I think it presents a really good opportunity. So we're starting to fill in the map further. Yes, sir.
You mentioned countryside. What about Lincolnshire Riverwoods Fire Department? Although they don't have much of a visible frontage because they're on whatever, is it Woodlands or Corporate Woods Road, whatever.
Right, off of Milwaukee Avenue.
Yeah. But they're an opportunity that we could share with them. The other is the Park District. Have we had discussions with them about possible areas like out on the island where it could be kind of be captured? Again, keeping malicious hands away at best.
Well, the electricity's at Summer Celebration site.
Yeah, yeah. So we are talking to the Park District also. They're one of our community partners that will be included. Lincolnshire Riverwoods will place a call to them. Okay, and so then banners and lights. In the board packet, it talks about lighting exists. Basically, it was the entrance to the light show before through the S-curve. We can add, there's 12 poles. We can add some snowflakes or similar. These are the ones we're recommending. Is this snowflake to the right-hand side? There's also a light at or outlet at Hawthorne in Lakeview, so in the median just to the west, so we want to add one there too. So I think what we're doing, instead of adding a lighted decoration on all 12 poles, we may do every other one and then take those other lights and distribute them in other areas. Let's see, looking at other outlets that we have found, the evergreen median here, we have an opportunity to add a light here. We will do so. Gross Point in 83, we have light out there, so we will add enhance that area. And then Westmoreland at 83, off of a pole, we previously have extended 100-foot conduit. Thank you. And we'll add some lighting at that location too.
Yeah, I was thinking also Firethorn Lake, like on a barge.
Work on that.
Get some real good marine batteries. Get that out there before it freezes.
So, and, you know, in terms of the banners, I just wanted to remind the board, we do have holiday banners that we put throughout town. You'll see them on Deer Path and around 60, et cetera, et cetera. We started to put together a map, but there's so many locations that we do have banners. It's a great opportunity. We'll continue to do it. You can see the Happy Holidays one on the far left side. That's consistent with what our banners look like. So we will continue to do that. And then opportunities in terms of the light poles. We went around the highway system and entrances to the village. We counted 71 light poles, and we're looking to add garland to all 71 of those poles, if so approved by the board. That'd be about $16,500 for the garland alone. So I just wanted to see if that's if you share my vision on that. Essentially, that's my presentation. Wanted to receive some feedback from the board.
We should decorate. Are we going to do something at the train station?
Yes, the train station, we will outline the building. We will add on the berm and evergreen trees. We will add lights on those evergreen trees. So the evergreen trees is a new enhancement. We'll enhance the building further than what we did last year.
Trustee Hebb.
I share your vision on the banners. I don't share your vision on the 14 or how much for the garland. I don't share your vision on the
okay.
Yeah.
That's okay.
The banners, they look both nice in the daytime, and they look nice at night, too, with the lighting. But I'm not real fond of people running around wrapping all the lights with the garland.
Okay. Good feedback.
Where do all the light poles at again?
Surrounding all of our highways, entrances to the subdivisions. So if you're going down 83 and you're going to Westmoreland, Northfield, Grosse Pointe, whatever pole is at the entrance, we would wrap it with garland. I appreciate your feedback on that. If we need to pull back on that, I appreciate if that's your direction, then we certainly will do that.
And it's 72 poles.
71.
71. Okay.
We could have missed one, though.
I'd rather see the banners, just because I think you're going to notice one during the day.
Okay.
But it would like be at either end of Deer Path and then coming into Hawthorne Club. And
yes. And many of those locations already have banners. So I understand your input. And if the board concurs with that, we can follow that direction.
I don't know.
I tend to agree that I like the banners better than just the garland.
Okay.
It's different if it were fresh, evergreen garland. It looks nice, but I'm not into the big stuff.
Okay.
Well, when it gets snow on it, it looks real.
Yeah, why? So it'll be like 50 degrees.
I don't have a problem with the banner. I mean, the banners are fine. I don't have a problem even with the garland, but so be it. What, are we doing snowflakes?
I like the snowflakes.
Snowflakes have to go on the light poles, right?
Yes, sir.
So the garland and the snowflakes go together?
If you're looking to cut budget, you'd cut the garland first.
Yes.
But, I mean, they go together.
They complement one another, yes.
Or
compliment. That's a good word.
Okay. What? I'll defer to the board's pleasure on this.
One of the options you may want to try is we may want to try a couple of locations, sure, and give you a chance to see what it looks like.
Yeah.
That's one option if you'd like to take that course. I think Dave is searching for, what we want to see going forward, and I think, yeah, again, to emphasize, I think this is going to grow over the year. I mean, we didn't really identify a budget for this type of decorating project, so to speak. So we're looking to start this.
Can we do garland then at like, I don't know.
A suggestion is maybe the roughly 15 snowflake ones, we add garland to those.
And put those at the highest traffic volume
right
location.
Yes.
So the two ends of Deer Path,
right,
would be two.
Something at 60, right?
Yeah.
60 in Lakeview?
Right.
Yeah, all right. So that means do about half of it?
A lot less than that, it sounds like.
Yeah.
Maybe.
I guess I think this is a work in progress, and you're going to have enough with everything else that you're going to have to do. So let's see how the first year goes, and we can always embellish on it the next year, because I'm more concerned about you keeping all this stuff lit and your guys running around and turning them on and turning them off and making sure, because I think that's going to be, it's nice when it was at Cooney, it was all there. But
well, the stuff that's attached to the streetlights, it'll just shut off.
That'll shut off.
When the streetlight goes off, right?
Yeah, I share trustee Hebda's, no, I started thinking, I share trustee Hebda's comment on that. I think our time's better spent on the displays that are ground mounted and chasing light bulbs and making sure they're lit. These ones, I don't see as many issues with the ones that are up on the poles.
Okay. Yeah, okay. All right, is that about it?
I would say if you're going to do garland, just do green. Don't do all this tinsel stuff.
Very good.
That would be my preference.
Not red and white, like a barber pole?
No,
something
not like
that.
Just green,
really?
If you're going to do garland.
We are proposing green.
That's just me, though. I don't know about the rest of the board.
We are proposing green unless we hear otherwise.
Yes, okay.
Okay, so you're still looking, and you're looking for direction from us to unload some of this.
Yes, so I think I have good direction from the board in terms of the program itself and the vision. The other thing is we have excess displays, whether it's the cutouts, which we've talked about with the cutouts, that we would share those through a lottery or other means.
Right.
Then there's the other ones that are the lit displays, which we will find some way to auction, sell, eBay, or some mechanism to disperse of those, but those would be, we would look to recoup some funds on those. So we would ask for your direction to do so.
Again, let's make sure we utilize all our potential contacts in town to potentially utilize them at parks, commercial enterprises, whatever, before we dispose of anything. Let's try and maximize our use with our in-town partner. Again, it's may we, Paris.
Okay.
Thank you for your direction.
If we're done, we're done.
I guess what I'd like to request is a motion to authorize the preparation of a disposal ordinance for these light displays and everything like that. We'll call out what we need to use for in the buildings, but I'd like to move forward and start sending these off down to other locations and other folks and the like.
What do we get for trailers?
So you need a motion to prepare an ordinance to dispose of the other?
Correct.
Okay, so made.
Second.
Motion is second. Roll call, please.
Trustee Schwartz? Trustee Williams? Trustee Hebda?
Aye.
Trustee Schultz?
Aye.
Trustee Marquardt?
Aye.
Trustee Cook?
Aye.
For the record, I'd vote aye.
Thank you so much.
Okay, is there a motion to adjourn committee to hold?
So made.
Second.
Motion is second. Roll call.
Trustee Williams? Trustee Hebda?
Aye.
Trustee Marquardt?
Aye.
Trustee Schultz?
Aye.
Trustee Cook?
Aye.
Trustee Schwartz?
Motion carries. Thank you. And next meeting.